Good evening, everybody. Welcome for our Maundy Thursday service. This is, as you know, a really new thing for us. Since you're all coming from different churches, and you may not have seen all of these people before, this is Craig Davis, who is the piano player here at Fairhaven. Yeah. This is Dan McKay from Spencer, and Emma Dolan, who also sings here. So as it turns out, we actually have not just your regular garden variety church musicians here, but all professionals. Emma was a worship leader professionally for some time. I knew that Craig was a jazz guy because he still does that. We went and saw him at the Cabaret Theater a few months ago. But Dan, as it turns out, has a master's in jazz performance as well. So, yeah.
What the hell?
So go figure. What we're going to do here tonight is walk through the Maundy Thursday story in a kind of jazz mood. Most of the songs will be familiar. You'll know them. I didn't make a bulletin because I think it's best for the service just to kind of sit in it, listen, hear the words. As we hear the scripture, as we walk through the story of Jesus' Last Supper, the washing of the disciples' feet, what they're going to open with is, you know, this was Dan showing his skill here. This is a piece called Persuasion. Craig described it as an art piece, very complex. But our prelude, if you'll close your eyes and begin in prayer, is called Persuasion.
Thank you.
This evening, we begin a solemn journey of 3 days that has changed the world, that's changed our own lives. Followers of Jesus have been taking this journey since his first followers took it long ago. And this evening, we hear Jesus' hopeful and haunting question, "Do you know what I have done?" On this night, Jesus took a towel and a basin and washed his disciples' feet. On this night, he told them to do the same for others, to show their love for him and for one another. On this night, it was a strange kind of dinner, a celebration, a holiday, where wine and bread were shared, but he was with his followers for one last time, expressing that he was going to be betrayed. He invited them to remember him, to encounter him again for the first time, whenever they did the same. On this night, followers of Jesus have welcomed those who have returned to the way of Jesus after a time of wandering and a journey of returning. And so on this night, we welcome those who are penitent, those who are seeking to turn back because all have wandered away. Today, we join in hearing and obeying the commandment of our Master and to feast at his table that we may love one another as he has loved us. Come, ye sinners, come, ye thirsty, come, ye weary. Taste and see, the Lord is good.
In my heart, Lord, I be like Jesus in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart.
On this night, Jesus gathered with those he loved as he headed to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. The Passover marked the liberation of God's people from slavery, from bondage in the land of Egypt. The people of Israel ate the Passover lamb, remembering the blood that protected them from judgment, that kept them safe, that would lead them to a new land. And this night, God asks his people to remember, "Do you know what I have done?" Our first reading from the Old Testament this evening comes from Exodus chapter 12. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month will be the first month. It will be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole Israelite community, on the 10th day of this month, they must take a lamb for each household, a lamb per house. If a household is too small for a lamb, it should share with a neighbor nearby. You should divide the lamb in proportion to the number of people who will be eating it. Your lamb should be a flawless year-old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You should keep close watch over it until the 14th day of this month. At twilight on that day, the whole assembled community of Israel should slaughter their lambs. They should take some of the blood and smear it on the two doorposts and on the beam over the door of the house in which they'll be eating. That same night, they should eat the meat roasted over the fire. They should eat it along with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Don't eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over a fire with its head, legs, and organs. Don't let any of it remain until the morning, and burn any of it left over in the morning. This is how you should eat it. You should be dressed, with your sandals on your feet and your walking stick in your hand. You should eat the meal in a hurry. It is the Passover of the Lord. I'll pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I'll strike down every oldest child in the land of Egypt, both humans and animals. I'll impose judgments on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. This blood will be your sign on the houses where you live. Whenever I see the blood, I'll pass over you. No plague will destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day will be a day of remembering for you. You will observe it as a festival to the Lord. You will observe it in every generation as a regulation for all time."
Maker and
As Jesus ate with his friends and with his disciples, they recalled the way that God saved his people. And Jesus looked toward how God was going to do it again. This time, the slave master was not Pharaoh, but death itself. And Jesus would be the Passover lamb whose blood would save. And the lamb would serve the lowest, even the one who would betray him. Jesus washed his disciples' feet, reversing roles of master and student, servant and host, and told them to do the same, to show the world God's love and theirs. "Do you know," he asks, "what I have done?" Our gospel reading comes from John's Gospel, chapter 13. Before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his time had come to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them fully. Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal. The devil had already provoked Judas, Simon Iscariot's son, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew the Father had given everything into his hands and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the table and took off his robes. Picking up a linen towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into the wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that he was wearing. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You don't understand what I'm doing now, but you will understand later." "No," Peter said, "you will never wash my feet." Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't have a place with me." Simon Peter said, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus responded, "Those who have bathed need only their feet washed, because they are completely clean. You disciples are clean, but not every one of you." He knew who would betray him. That's why he said, "Not every one of you is clean." After he washed the disciples' feet, he put on his robes and returned to his place at the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you speak correctly because I am. If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you too must wash each other's feet. I have given you an example. Just as I have done, you must also do. I assure you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are those who are sent greater than those who's the one who sent them. Since you know these things, you will be happy if you do them." When Judas was gone, Jesus said, "Now the human one has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will glorify the human one in himself and will glorify him immediately. Little children, I'm with you for a little while longer. You will look for me, but just as I told the Jewish leaders, I also tell you now, where I'm going, you can't come. I give you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you must also love each other. This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, when you love each other." What I'm going to do now is read this one more time. And at the end, I'll invite you, if you're comfortable, to say a word, a phrase that stuck out to you, something that you have heard. You don't need to give a sermon. But just whatever it is that you're hearing tonight in this word of Scripture. Here again, John's Gospel. Before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his time had come to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who are in the world, he loved them fully. Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal. The devil had already provoked Judas, Simon Iscariot's son, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew the Father had given everything into his hands, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the table and took off his robes. Picking up a linen towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into the wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that he was wearing. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You don't understand what I'm doing now, but you will understand later." "No," Peter said, "you will never wash my feet." Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't have a place with me." Simon Peter said, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus responded, "Those who have bathed need only to have their feet washed, because they are completely clean. You disciples are clean, but not every one of you." He knew who would betray him. That's why he said, not every one of you is clean. After he washed the disciples' feet, he put on his robes and returned to his place at the table. And he said to them, do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you speak correctly because I am. If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you too must wash each other's feet. I have given you an example. Just as I have done, you also must do. I assure you, servants aren't greater than their master, nor are those who are sent greater than the one who sent them. Since you know these things, you will be happy if you do them. When Judas was gone, Jesus said, now the human one has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify the human one in himself and will glorify him immediately. Little children, I am with you for a little while longer. You will look for me. But just as I told the Jewish leaders, I also tell you now, where I'm going, you can't come. I give you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you must also love each other. This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, when you love each other. Anything. Bibi.
This says it all.
Yeah. Love one another.
Pray for the Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Everybody has to love everybody.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Any other words, phrase? Yes. Kelly.
He loved them fully.
Mm-hmm. You got to go first, though.
Jamie.
He says, you must wash each other's feet.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say you have to love other people even when they don't love you back.
Mm-hmm.
As hard as that can be. Mm-hmm. Or to forgive people that don't love you and hurt you, just as we would have.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Okay. Sitting around the table with his disciples, Jesus looked at them and looked beyond them. He could see the cross on the horizon and right across the table, the deadly betrayal that one of them had already committed. And yet he bent to wash each disciple's feet, carefully tending to each, doing the work of a servant. He washed the very dust off Judas' feet that stuck to him like guilt as he'd slinked away to hand Jesus over for a bag of coins. Peter sits before him, barefoot, soul-bared. And Jesus says to him and to us, you don't understand what I'm doing now, but you will understand later. 2 dozen feet washed in near silence, time dripping slowly by, when he returns to the table. Do you know, he asks, what I've done for you? Though, of course, they don't. You call me teacher and Lord, so do what I have done. I have loved you. Love one another. He looked off again, staring a hole through the wall in the house toward the hill called the Place of the Skull. Love one another. I'm with you for a little while longer, and where I'm going, you can't come.
I'm going there
That night, Jesus invited to the table to be served all who loved him and one who didn't. He invited those who were faithful and those who would betray him the very next day. And so even today, Christ invites to his table all who love him, who repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with God and each other. And therefore, we approach this table as Christ washes our feet, as he breaks the bread. And confess. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful God, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Pass over us, therefore. Grant us, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your Son, Jesus Christ, and drink his blood that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. When your people were sojourners, slaves in Egypt, you spoke to Moses in a burning bush. You called out to him, told him to take off his shoes, and raised him up to be the leader of your people. Through him, you worked miracles in the land. You brought the plagues to Egypt that shook Pharaoh to his core. When the plagues failed, you spoke to Moses again, and you gave him and the people the commandment of the Passover, that the Lamb would save them all. And so we join all your people of past, present, and future, those who are saved through the blood of the Lamb. Praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the fullness of time, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, who'd been with you since the beginning, to save your people once more. He ate with sinners. He invited them to his table. He walked with all of those who had sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. When the time came that he would reach the end of his life, that he had provoked Herod's wrath, that he'd provoked the wrath of the religious authorities, you turned his face towards Jerusalem, where he would go over Jordan to meet you once more. He broke bread. He gave it to his disciples. He poured out his blood. He washed their feet, bending down before them as a servant and their master. In all of these things, in his weakness, he became mighty. And by laying down his life, he gained life for us all. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
That night, which we remember this evening, Christ sat at the table. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you once more. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and wine, on all of us gathered here, that these may be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, and that we may be the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood for all the world. And now in the confidence of children of God, we pray the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Here is the source of every sacrament, the all-transforming presence of the Lord, replenishing our every element, remaking us in his creative work. For here the earth herself gives bread and wine, the air delights to bear his spirit's speech, the fire dances where the candles shine, the waters cleanse us with his gentle touch. And here he shows us the full extent of love, to whose love is always incomplete. In vain we search the heavens high above. The God of love is kneeling at our feet. Though we betray him, though it is the night, he meets us here and loves us into the light. This is the body of Christ, the bread of life. And this is the cup that saves us and sets us free.
I invite you now. Does everyone have a communion cup? If you don't, just lift your hand real quick and we'll get one down to you. A reminder for those of you who might not know the United Methodist tradition, the table is open in the United Methodist Church to all who love Christ, who seek to love Christ, who repent of their sins. And so together, we take first the body. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ poured out for you.
Could not satisfy, fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting in my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till this world gave you. Leave hunger that won't pass away. My blessed Lord will come and save you. If you kneel to him and
like the disciples, oh God, we don't understand what it is that you have done for us. We know what you have done, and we'll understand someday. But for now, we give you thanks for the mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hold on a second, that was weird.
What wondrous love is this, oh my soul?
As we move through this Holy Week, I invite you to join us for worship again tomorrow for our tenebrae service, which is at Spencer at 7:30. We will also be having a crosswalk beginning at Hilltop, carrying a cross up the hill, stopping to read the story of the Passion of Christ, before ending the walk at Abiding Missions. It'll take about 30, 40 minutes, where they'll strip the altar and we'll say some prayers before heading out. But I hope you're able to join us somewhere tomorrow. But until then, go in the peace of Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit now and always. Amen. Yeah.